Thank you, Jinhee, as usual. She's wonderful, isn't she? Well, are you ready to worship God? I saw one hand go up. One person's ready to worship. Thank you for coming to Narberth Presbyterian Church this morning. We're glad to have you. We have some surprises this morning I think you'll like. Danny Awad is with us from Baruch Presbyterian in Bethlehem, Israel. He'll talk to you for a minute or two, along with some other surprises from the children and others. It's good to be alive and be Christian, isn't it? Let's worship God together. And Debbie's going to lead us in the call.
That's printed in your, it's up on the board as well. So wherever you're looking, you should be able to see the words. Let's call ourselves to worship. Loving God, we come to you in worship and thanksgiving. You are greater than we can understand. You are more loving than our hearts can respond to. You are wiser than we can know. Loving God, in Jesus, you chose to come to the world in humility. You chose the path the world saw as foolish. Amen. Let's stand and sing praise to our Father God in heaven.
Thank you.
be seated. I'd like to invite Emmy Davis to read our scripture now.
Our scripture reading is Isaiah chapter 58, verses 6 through 11. Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, and set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe them, and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointed finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, who could hear the words of that scripture reading and not realize that we have not necessarily been perfect in all that? The Lord knows that. The Lord knows us. The Lord loves us and calls us back from wherever we may have wandered this week. When we say sorry to the Lord, he says, "I forgive you." With that in mind, let's turn to the Lord in our printed confession and then spend a few moments in silent confession. Let's pray together. When we come into the holy presence of God, our own humanity is laid bare. When we stand in the living presence of truth, our own falsehood is revealed. People of God, let us acknowledge who we are and ask our ever-present God to forgive us. Amen. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always accuse, nor will he keep his anger forever. God does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is God's steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he removes our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion for those who fear him. May the words of the psalmist be the words of our hearts and the reality of our lives. Hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we truly are forgiven and made new. Amen. Right now, it's my pleasure to invite Linda Bemke up, and she is going to introduce someone some of us had the joy of meeting when we went to the Holy Land a year ago, December, and who is now here with us.
Good morning. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing you to my friend, Reverend Danny Awad, who's from the real Bethlehem, not our Bethlehem. Danny is the pastor of Baraka Presbyterian Church, could be called First Presbyterian Church, could be called Only Presbyterian Church, but they call it Baraka. He's here with us for about 10 days, visiting with the presbytery, so we'll be doing, we have him on a road tour. Kind of, but you will also have the opportunity to hear from him on Wednesday evening and let him introduce himself a little bit further this morning.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you here. Worship the Lord God Almighty. Yes, I came from the true Bethlehem. But it's nice to be home here in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. It's always it's great to be here with you and worship the Lord God Almighty and my wife, Joy. She's in the back there. She's sitting with me. I came from a church called Baraka, Presbyterian Church. Baraka, it's mean a blessing. It's an Arabic Hebrew word that mean a blessing. So it's a blessing, Presbyterian Church. It is the only Presbyterian church in the country there. Literally, it's the only. It is the only Presbyterian church, and I am the second ordained minister in the church there. My father, he was the senior pastor, and then the Lord called me to go to the seminary and study the Bible there, so I came back and serving the Lord in Bethlehem. Bethlehem is a very small little town, just like on Christmas when you sing "Oh, little town of Bethlehem." It's literally very small, but it is not that small. It's full of traffic. It's full of traffic, so you need at least maybe half an hour to move from one place to other place with the traffic in a very small town. And we are, as a Christian there, we are minority among the minority. We are minority among the minority. Literally, we are 0.1. In number, exactly, we are 38,000 Christian. I mean Christian including all evangelicals, family, Catholics, and others in the whole country, not on just in Bethlehem, but in the whole country. And to be and to live and to serve the Lord, let me say it, in the land of conflict. I'm sure you hear the news every day. Since 75 years, we're hearing the news. It's still the same. Rocket coming from there, bomb from there, problems here. It's life very difficult there. But we always look to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The disciples came to Jesus. And they were worried about the situation, what's going on. But to make the long story short, Jesus told them, "You are the salt of the earth. No matter how we are big in number or small in number, no matter if we are the majority or the minority, but the Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, asked us to be the good salt. And I'm sure every mom, when you make the food in the home, you just put a dash of salt. We'll not put 5 kilos of salt in one square of food. We just put dash of salt. And that's, we are the dash of the believers in Bethlehem. I really challenge you, I really ask you to pray for the living stone in Bethlehem. We have thousands of tourists every day coming to Bethlehem. Believe me, thousands of tourists. They like to visit the dead stone, which is the historical places, which I called it the dead stone. It's nice to go to see where Jesus was walking, where Jesus was born and all these things. But very few Christians, very few tourists, when they come to Bethlehem, they said, "We want to go and worship with the living stone." The minority among the minority. I really thank you. And when you came, you visited our church and you came to us. This is the living stone. I really challenge you, whenever you come to Israel or to Palestine or whatever you want to name it, we have many names there. Palestine, Israel, East Jerusalem, West Jerusalem, West Bank, whatever. But don't forget your brothers and sisters in the Lord who are in the front line, who need your prayers. I have three children, three daughters. They are back home in Bethlehem. I am sure you hear the news last night. Believe me and my wife would not sleep the whole night. You know, it's very difficult to be away from my children and the rockets over their heads. You know, it is not easy, but we want to serve the Lord. We want to be a good light. We want to be a good salt, and we need your prayers. Yes, you are in the USA, I'm in Palestine or in Israel, but we have the same Father. We have the same Son who died in the cross for our sins. We have the same Bible that we hold in our hand. Yes, we may argue what kind of translation, King James, NIV, American Standard Version, doesn't make sense to me. But what makes sense to me is the Word of God. And the Word of God must be alive for all people around the world as His love to everyone. So again, I challenge you to pray for the living stone. Yes, we are in Easter time, but especially during Christmas, when you sing, O little town of Bethlehem, remember your brothers and sisters who are facing difficulties, who are facing the war, who are facing the death every day for the sake of the gospel. And thank you again. I promise I will not stay long. May the Lord bless each one of you.
Come on out for supper Wednesday night and get to spend a couple hours with Danny and Joy. And you can learn something more. When we had lunch with him, we ditched the rest of the afternoon and just kept talking. It'll be wonderful. And remember to pray. And now you have a face here and a face here to remember as you do. Thank you so much. Thank you, Linda. Paul said that Jesus is our peace, who has broken down every dividing wall of hostility that there could be between people. And praise God for his peace, named Jesus. As God has given us peace through his Son, let us share that peace and ourselves with one another now in this moment as we stand and greet one another with the love of Christ. The peace of the Lord be with you.
We serve a living king. As we sing this song this morning, see Jesus. See the giver of bread. He's strong and he's kind, and he's calling us this morning. His resurrection makes our daily need for resurrection a possibility, a reality. So as we sing this next song, just let the Holy Spirit show you what resurrection, what the resurrection of Jesus means for each one of you. Because it looks different in each one of our lives, right? The resurrection, it kind of manifests in different ways. Salt tastes different every day. But it's all beautiful in a different way. So let him show you what his resurrection means for you this day.
The head
And thank you, Lord, you call dead things to life. Thank you, Lord, for your resurrection. We love you this morning.
Amen. Please be seated. And as our musicians assemble to worship the Lord through the offering of their music and themselves, just like to say how wonderful it is that this is a church where every age is represented in leadership, including leadership in worship. And this is on display today, but many Sundays here, may it be increasingly so. Not the future of the church, the now is here. And so, as we come to a time where we pass the friendship pads, sign in so that we know who is here and are encouraged during the week, as we look at those and remember you in prayer. And as we come to offer the Lord ourselves along with whatever else comes out of our hands and our hearts, I'd like to ask you this week to keep in mind the ministry of a number of people who gather every other Thursday in the parlor to craft quilts for people undergoing chemotherapy. That is especially poignant today. Please keep this ministry and its people and the people it blesses in prayer, and come, let us worship God in all that we are and all that we have.
I
Dear Father, we know you're here today. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for leading this church the last 120 years. Let us be optimistic enough to think we can be here in some other form for another 120 years. Thank you for the gifts and offerings and tithes that have come here this morning. Thank you for the way the church goes about the business of giving as if it were the ordinary thing. That is not the case in so many churches. You know them all. Here we feel blessed, and we try to bless others. Bless these gifts as they find their way to further your kingdom through the stewardship of this church. In Christ's name we pray these things. Amen. Please be seated. This morning, we're going to take a few moments to do what we call the prayers of the people and play musical chairs while we're doing it. There we go. Before we get into that, this service is going to run long, so just get comfortable. Before we do that, as the children go out, can we give them another round of applause? Wasn't that great? So you know how this drill works. We have a whole list of people in the bulletin that we're praying for. We're certainly remembering Pastor Steve this morning as he begins to recover from his recent surgery, along with Jan, also recovering from a recent surgery. There's so many more. But we miss people, don't we? We miss people that we might can cover right here, right now, as we can lift them up by name and pray for them together. What has happened to you this week that impressed you somehow? It might have been negative, it might have been positive. Maybe you had a blessing or saw something that just stopped you in your tracks, and you praise God right there. Or maybe there's somebody in your heart that you know of that just needs our prayers right now. So let me ask you to not get over your shyness and raise your hand, and Cindy will come up to you, and we'll find out who that is and write them down, and we'll pray for them right now. Okay? Cindy down here, a couple people. Let's start with Linda.
Good morning. I'm going to ask for a prayer for my oldest son, Andy, and his wife, Debbie. They're having some difficulties, and they really need your prayers. And I would appreciate that so much. And I have a praise also for my younger sister, who has a new outlook on her surgery upcoming. They're giving her a 95% chance instead of a zero chance, so that's an awesome thing. Her name is Carolyn. And it's an aneurysm surgery, so.
Her name is what?
Carolyn.
Carolyn, got it.
This is her third aneurysm surgery, so she's doing great.
Thank you, Linda. Got it, right over here, Cindy. Right here, Cindy.
My sister Julia and her husband Stan have both been looking for jobs for several months, and it's been a long and discouraging process, but they both have some interviews coming up in the next week, so I'm praying for them.
Absolutely. Thank you to me. Over here. Thanks.
I want to just share the information that was on the news this morning in the paper, where Iran has started bombing Israel. And it's devastating to that country again, all that they've been through. So we need to really put great efforts and bring this war to a close. It's just heartbreaking to me that it continues week after week and all the innocent people are being harmed or killed, no matter what. But the Lord is the one to find the answer for this. So I think we all need to give an extra oomph with our prayers in this circumstance.
Good morning. So everybody's been praying for my dad, so I just want to continue to pray for him. He came out of dialysis, and they just don't treat him very well there, and he fell asleep in his truck for a couple hours, and they just let him sit there. So we've been encouraging him to try to find a new dialysis place that would treat him better. And apparently that's a common thread that with dialysis places, that at least with, you know, according to him, that is just kind of the treatment that they get there. Then for Silas, my friend Mark and Lisa's baby, he was at CHOP for about a week or so. I think he's still there, and he's got a feeding tube. He's only a couple months old, and just not gaining enough nutrition. So, and he's had some difficulties with digestion and some other things, but I pray that feeding tube comes out and he can come home.
To remind me of your father's name.
Same as mine.
Mike. Gotcha.
Good morning. Two prayer requests. One for the McNicholas family of Havertown. They are a family of six children. They lost their father to a stroke. So please pray for them. And also for our neighbor, Mary, continues going through chemotherapy for her continued healing.
Thank you. Thank you, Jay. Jinhee, back in the back. She never listens to me.
It's just because she saw my hand up. I would love to ask for prayer for my father, David, who is for physical healing due to work fatigue and stress. So physical healing for my father. Thank you.
In the back.
Could we please pray for Ben Duffy? He's one of our mission causes. He's in Jerusalem right now. And also for my best friend's daughter, Dara, and Yoel, and their two daughters in northern Israel.
Did you say Jara?
Dara.
Got it. Okay.
This past week, I was so blessed to be part of the solitude and meditation retreat that Clara offered up to this church. We had a few people there. I have never been part of something like that before, and I don't think I've ever been quiet a whole day without speaking at all. But it was pretty amazing to enjoy the beautiful surroundings of St. Raphael's and just to be in prayer and meditation and thought. If you ever have a chance to do something like that, I would highly recommend it. It's not easy, but it's really beneficial.
Anyone else? Well, let's go to God in prayer. Whoop. Debbie has a mic.
yesterday, about 100 people gathered in this sanctuary to worship God and to give thanks for the life of Kathy Jacobs, who with her husband Don were part of the choir and were just, along with their daughter Jackie, knit into this congregation. There were many people from outside the church and a number of us from within, and it was a good time, and the Lord was in our midst. It's the right way to say goodbye to one we have loved. So thank you for your prayers for that family. Please continue to pray for Jackie in this new world she finds herself. Thank you.
Let's pray together. your father. It's impressive just to hear the silence in this room. So many people gathered and so many people reverent to that which is happening here. Help us to be present in your presence, not just in this room, but in all the rooms of our lives as we go and come to and fro. Help us to know you're right beside us, guiding us in ways that we don't even know, reminding us of your sweet presence and the love that encompasses us. You've given us ways and means to understand you, from your word to the creation of family, to creation itself, as we look about and see all the beauty that surrounds us, natural beauty. We don't have to work for it, but there it is in all its splendor. As we drive on our way to appointments, help us to be present there in those moments when you're finding ways to talk to us, to communicate with us, to slow us down, to make us hear that still, small voice with all the majesty of all creation packed behind it, and yet you entreat us tenderly. We have much to be thankful for this morning. We pray for many. And at this moment, we pray for several individually, people who might have been forgotten for a moment. We thank those who spoke out this morning to bring these people to our attention, to our prayer list, to our minds. We pray specifically for blessing Baruka Presbyterian. It may be an ocean away, but it is part of your house. And we thank you for Pastor Danny's ministry there, for his involvement with ECO, and for our involvement back to see how we can be brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray for Andy and Debbie and Carolyn and Julia and Stan. We pray for Steve and Jan as they're in recovery. We pray for Mike and baby Silas. We pray for Mary and chemo, for the Nicholas family. We pray for Kathy Jacobs family and Dara. We pray for Daniel. We pray for Jack Comstock's cousin Terry, who's entered into hospice due to cancer. We pray for Mary, that she might find employment. We pray for another Mary and her six children and grandchildren. We pray for David. And now we pray for all those other unspoken that we lift up to you right now. They're not unspoken to you. You know exactly who they are. We pray that we all will let you into our lives in such a way that we're never far from you. That we come to you and make you part of our decision making, part of who we are. Father, last and so far from least, we pray for a people divided in Israel and Palestine, for a region so loaded with strife and conflict for these many centuries. The very center of creation, still at war, still hurting each other. And as we pray for them, we think about our own country, a country divided by political battles, a country where we are no longer able to have constructive dialogue with one another. Father, we've strayed a long way from what you've taught us. Help bring us back. And help this church be part of that effort as we show unity here in such a kind and generous way. May we do so when we're on the other side of these doors, and may it be contagious. And now we pray in the name of him who taught us how to pray, saying together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I like to hear the sound of babies. I was trying to locate where it was. Let's turn to Genesis. We'll start our scripture there this morning in Genesis 2, starting with verse 8. And we're going to jump from Genesis to Matthew. So the first book of each testament, we'll read a little bit as we begin a new sermon series called Trees of Life. Genesis 2, starting with verse 8. And the Lord planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. A river flowed out of Eden to water the garden, and there it divided and became four rivers. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It's the one that flowed around the whole land of Cush. And the name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, You may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Then the Lord God said, It's not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. Now turn with me to Matthew in the 26th chapter, and we'll start with verse 36. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, Sit here while I go over and pray. And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. And then he said to them, My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me. And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, So you couldn't watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, My Father, if this cannot pass, unless I drink it, your will be done. And again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. These are the words of God. Let's pray together. Dear Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Let me welcome this morning those that couldn't be here with us physically that are present online. We're glad to have you as well. We hope you've gotten that second cup of coffee and you're sitting down and you're ready to hear the message with us. And this message this morning is called A Tale of Three Gardens. How many of you have ever had a vegetable garden? Raise your hands. Pretty good for Pennsylvania. I remember helping plant and weed vegetable gardens as a boy. We always planted green beans and lettuce and squash, tomatoes, usually a row or two of corn, maybe some cantaloupes and cucumbers, although they took up a lot of space. I don't much think that gardening saved us any money, but it taught me to respect the soil for what it can yield if taken care of properly. It taught me that much can come from little. Not bad advice for living. Later, I found myself doing the same thing with my own children, and I'm sure it never saved us any money either. But it taught those same lessons to my children. You know, there are all kinds of gardens. There are vegetable gardens, but there are also flower gardens and rock gardens and water gardens and more. The definitions of garden all had to do with a planned space, a space set aside for cultivation. The Bible makes a number of references to gardens, although I could only find two gardens actually named in the Bible, one in the Old, one in the New Testament. The Old Testament garden we just read about, it's the Garden of Eden. The Bible first refers to it in Genesis 2:8. Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east, in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Garden of Eden is a very special garden. We'll come back and talk more about that in a little bit. The other garden named in the Bible is in the New Testament, and it's the Garden of Gethsemane. It's mentioned by name in all the synoptic gospels. You know what synoptic means. It's like same. Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they're more or less the same. John just calls it an olive grove. This too is a very special garden. This morning I want to talk to you about these two gardens and what significance they have to us as Christians. And while we do that, I want you to be thinking about any other gardens that occur to you. Imagine, if you will, a massive garden. A garden big enough to have a river flowing through it. A river with four major tributaries reaching out north and south and east and west. A garden with all kinds of trees, trees pleasing to the eye. And I'm thinking of silver maples, one of my favorites, and live oaks and redwoods, magnolias. Don't we have one right out here? And trees good for food like bananas and orange and apple trees. Imagine all that in this garden, and then imagine all the birds and beasts of the world. God brought every one of them to Adam to name. Imagine if you could sit among such splendor with lions and lambs and eagles and zebras at your feet and living together. Imagine having no need for grocery stores. or air conditioning, or even money. Imagine a God so wonderful, so attentive and perceptive to your needs, that even after he has given everything to you, he can see that something is missing. And he carves woman from your own rib to keep you company, to be your helpmate, your peer, your friend. And now imagine being told that you're going to be in charge of it all, subject only to God's sovereignty over you. This is the picture that is described in Genesis 2. We rewrite through it in half a minute or a minute, and we go on to the next thing. We need to pause. We need to think about how incredibly glorious that must have been. It's so unbelievable that now when we say the word Eden, we use it to describe some sort of paradise. Eden is a garden, a planned space made by God for man's pleasure. It's perfect. There's no pain. There's no hard labor. There's no strife. There's only harmony. The Garden of Eden no longer exists. But hints are given at its former location. They're right there in Genesis. It mentions an intersection of the Tigris and the Euphrates rivers. And they still exist. They're in Baghdad. That intersection is just a little different today than in the time of Adam. What a difference a few millenniums make. But think about it. The Garden of Eden was not in heaven. It was right here on earth. The Garden of Gethsemane still exists. It's a peaceful garden, nestled among a grove of ancient olive trees right outside Jerusalem. The garden still contains dozens of olive trees that are believed to date back 2,000 years. Can you imagine? There may even now be trees in this garden that were saplings on the night of Jesus' arrest. I was there last year and I saw those grand old trees with my own eyes. They're gigantic. They're bigger around than this pulpit. And they're gnarled like you would expect something aged to be, but they're alive. They're very much alive. And it brought tears to my eyes to think about the events of that night. Not so long ago in the history of our existence. Gethsemane is a garden also. It's a planned space also. It's made by man, not God. And it's a place in which Jesus, in pain, appealed to God. The imagery of our biblical gardens is quite contrasting. I was reminded of that this morning when the praise band was singing. All the contrasts in resurrecting from humility and what looked like apparent defeat to victory and majesty beyond our description through resurrection. I want you to think about this. In a perfect garden crafted by God, Adam takes the fall. In a man-made garden full of weeds, Jesus takes a stand. In the perfection that is Eden, God must go looking for the man, Adam. And in the stillness of that spring night on a garden hillside in Gethsemane, the man, Jesus, is looking for God. Man hides from his creator in Eden. In Gethsemane, Jesus sees the tomb that awaits him, and rather than hiding like Adam did in Eden, he invites his fate by praying not once but three times for God's will to be done. In Eden, Satan leads Adam to a tree that led to his death. in Gethsemane, Jesus volunteers to hang from a tree that will lead to life for mankind. The death that is to end a life instead helps to bring life, eternal life, for all who would believe. In these scenes, we see God's heavenly power and majesty at work. And there's such irony in the way these two stories unfold. While the Garden of Eden was made by God, the real story of that garden is man. And while the Garden of Gethsemane was made by man, the real story of that garden is all about God. Like all good stories, there's a villain. In the Garden of Eden, as in all the gardens of our lives, we have evil to contend with. Satan appears in the form of a serpent. The image is so powerful that to this day, many still associate snakes with something sinister and evil. Some would tell you that evil is nothing more than the absence of God. It's really not bad in and of itself. It's just the absence of God. Evil isn't a real presence. I think they're reading a different Bible from you and me. Is evil real? Is it a presence in this world? In John 8:44, Jesus himself characterizes the devil as a murderer from the beginning, a liar, and the father of lies. In chapter 12, 14, and 16 of John's gospel, Jesus himself refers to Satan as the ruler of this world or the prince of this world. Think about this. Do you know a place where evil does not exist? Is there a realm here on this planet that's untouched by Satan? Some of you are probably saying to yourselves, well, sure, there's church. I heard that. I'm afraid the church is no more immune than anywhere else. Satan was in the Garden of Eden, right under God's nose in God's paradise on earth. Satan was in the desert with Jesus, tempting him at the beginning of his ministry. Now, if Satan was there at the beginning in Eden, and there at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, you can bet he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. He knew what was coming, and he had way too much to lose not to be there. Besides, you know what happened after Jesus prayed. Roman soldiers, temple guards, Judas. Satan was there, all right. And if Satan was in both these gardens, you can be sure that he's in the church and anywhere else he wants to be in this world. He's here to tempt, he's here to persuade, he's here to corrupt. But what about marriage? Or children? Aren't they sacred? Well, of course they are. But that doesn't stop Satan. Satan loves to go to our sacred institutions. Satan has been killing marriages and children and morality since the beginning. He's the father of incest and abuse. He was killing infants to kill Moses. He was using Herod to kill infants to get to the baby Jesus. He used the Crusades to spread enmity in the name of Christ himself. He used Hitler to effect a Jewish Holocaust in Europe. He used genocide to wipe out millions in Rwanda not 25 years ago. And he uses Putin today to attack the free people of Ukraine in the name of nationalism. He uses alcohol, drugs, pornography, bigotry to weaken moral resolve. We invent and perfect this miracle of communication and social media, and Satan uses it to divide us. The sword of Satan has cut a wide swath in the path of history. And there's not a place or an institution that is immune from his influence. Most of you have heard of Max Licato. Max calls him the pimp of the garden. What Satan did in Eden, he does today in our governments, our churches, our schools, even our homes. Unless we're finally to the good part. Unless Jesus is in the building. The very fact that Satan is alive and well makes it paramount that we know that what Jesus did in Gethsemane, he does today. There was no intimidation of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Although about to be arrested, he told 200 plus soldiers to let all his disciples go. And not a word was said in protest. Although his life hung in the balance, Jesus basically lectured Pontius Pilate to a stalemate and was declared innocent. Although hanging on a cross with nails in his body, he forgave a thief being crucified, as well as those crucifying him. So think about this. Jesus was in control, even on the cross. From the garden, he did not run. From the cross, he made no attempt to escape. And Satan, think about that. Satan was quiet. Satan never contradicts Jesus. When Jesus stands and speaks, Satan is silent. And he stumbles. In Eden, God gave Adam a choice about his destiny, the tree of life, or the tree of knowledge of good and evil. An extraordinary gift, made more so by the fact that our Lord had made Adam, as he did you and me, in his own image. But Adam didn't have the benefit of hindsight. He didn't have a Bible to read. He didn't have a history to understand and guide him. He and Eve were the first. And Adam chose to satisfy his selfish curiosity. Maybe he did it innocently, I don't know. Maybe it didn't occur to him that his selfishness was disobedience. But in doing so, he chose to disobey God. And he stumbled. That fall was made possible by the very free will that allows us this day to choose or reject God. I can't blame Adam. He sort of reminds me of a world-class athlete or a celebrity superstar who has too much fame, too much money, too little accountability. You can just see the fall coming. Eden is about man being, well, man. Adam loses. Mankind loses. Satan is identified for the enemy for all, as the enemy for all time. But even there, God does not abandon. Let's turn to Gethsemane for a minute. Gethsemane is a different story. It's still the story of a man. But here we see a man in full harmony with God. Yes, Jesus is the Son of God. But here he is still fully man, showing us what love is all about. In the fullness of time, God has come to another garden to begin that last journey to guarantee our acceptance in his kingdom. Jesus' sacrifice is our admission ticket. And although Satan has stacked the deck by poisoning the hearts of Judas and the high priest and the Sanhedrin and even the Roman authorities, he has no power over the Son of God. Jesus is in control. There are many players in the Garden of Gethsemane that night, the 11 disciples, Judas, the temple guard, as many as 200 soldiers. There are subplots, Judas and the betrayal, Peter and his sword, the inner circle of Peter, James and John falling asleep, all these things going on. But make no mistake, the real encounter is the showdown between God and Satan, with Jesus as the centerpiece. That's the message in Gethsemane, and the message has never changed. The Apostle Paul spells it out for us in Ephesians 6. He says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil, even in the heavenly realms." And 1 John 3:8 finishes this thought with this message: the Son of God came for this purpose, to destroy the devil's work. 2,000 years or so have gone by since that night, and the story of that confrontation and of the crucifixion and death and resurrection and ascension that followed have changed and continued to change the world. I am so thankful that Danny could be here this morning to remind us that even a third of the way around the world, the same issues are there. They're there more violently than they are in Narberth, but they're the same issues. And Jesus is the answer there, just like he is here. Well, we've talked about two great biblical gardens. One still exists today. Another has gone for a time, but the book of Revelation seems to promise us that we might see it again. But the name of the message was Three Gardens. And there is still another, a garden for whom the other gardens of the world exist. There is one great garden in the house of God, and it's not Eden or Gethsemane or any other place. It's us. We are God's garden. He fertilizes us with his word. He nourishes us with his Holy Spirit. And he brings us life through his Son, Jesus. And if we'll just let him, if we'll just ask him in, he will weed Satan from our lives and leave us as clean and fresh as the dew on the grass in early morning. When Jesus says he will keep you safe, he means it. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against him. And that's the message for today. Now here's a question for you. And for me, what are the weeds in your garden? What thorns are in the way of your relationship with the Master? I see heads nodding. We've all got it, don't we? Of course we do. And they're different. Some are alike, and many are different. Is it love of money? Is it your job? Is it your lack of a job? An unhealthy relationship with someone, addiction of some sort, there are hundreds. Maybe it's time. Are you too busy for Jesus? Maybe it's as simple as trying to rein in the business of your life. Has Satan invaded a garden of your life? What's he taking from you right now? Look inside yourself. Be honest, and you'll see it. And it doesn't have to be that way. You can stop it. Just let Jesus claim it back. Don't let Satan have authority over you. If he's invaded a garden of your life, weed him out here and now. You know, you can't do that by yourself. I bet you figured that out. But you can do it with Jesus. He can stand up for you and he can take Satan from your life, just like he stared him down in Gethsemane and on the cross. Why don't you do that with me right now? He's listening, so let's pray. Father, I praise your name. I was lost and you found me. When I stumbled, you helped me up. When I fell, you carried me. When I was confused, you guided me. You've reclaimed so much in my life. I had and still have nothing to offer you, but you love me anyway. Father, you know I still need help. I can't walk alone. Satan is battling for a garden in my heart, and sometimes I feel so weak. Please don't let him win. Please help me come to you. Please drive him out, and I'll give you all the glory. And all God's people said, Amen. Let's stand together and sing, Thou Didst Leave Thy Throne, hymn 198. one for the record. If we stay here another 10 minutes, I might make it. It didn't seem that long to me this morning. I hope it didn't to you either. We have so many announcements, and they're all important. I just want to point out to you quickly, the book fair is the next couple of days. You should come and take advantage. Presbyterian meeting this coming Friday and Saturday. Any of those of you who are interested, you can come. Just let me know. You can come with me. There is a retreat on the 27th about telling your story, and I wish every one of you would come to that. Get your story ready and get me out of the pulpit. We'll tell your stories instead. And it goes on. The all-church picnic is coming right at us, the retreat. Please read the bulletin. It's got great stuff in it. And now before I give a blessing, Daniel, would you join me and help give this blessing? Come on up. It's great to have the pastor from Blessing Church here, don't you think? So if you would, let's just raise our hands together and I'll say a blessing. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and give you joy and peace. And may you go in peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Walk with me.